When we look at Cleopatra, and we see that Rome had another problem with her. So Cleopatra did a trick on Rome. She said, I am a Set, and your people have worshipped me from the time of your beginning, which they did. The Greeks, the Romans, they took her throughout their empire. They took her to Gaul. They took her to Britannia, that is now Britain. They took her to Germania, which is Germany. That's why you got the Black Madonna there. So that was a problem. They said, we got to change this, because that is Augustus Caesar's enemy, Cleopatra. And now she's making herself Isis, who they worshipped in their own history. Cleopatra is all the way in the back of this temple right here, a temple of Heru. So we'll go in the back and we'll speak on her a little bit. When Alexander comes in as a mercenary to fight the Persians who were here. The Persians were reaping havoc on Kemet. So again, they came in as mercenaries, but if you got a mercenary fighting for you, when they kick out the enemy, what are they going to do? They're going to take over if you can't defend yourself, and that's exactly what happened with Alexander the Barbarian that they taught you to call the Great. Nothing great about him, all right? Here they got us to call him Great. That was taken from Menkheperatuhudi Maize, the Great. That was taken from Ursima Atra Septepen Ra Ramesu Muri Amun, the Great. That's where the concept the Great came from. But when he took over Kemet, this is where he got Aristotle to plunder temples like this and up and down the Nile and plunder the scrolls that were here and the libraries and house it in the Alexandria Library. This is where they started to study ancient Kemet. But after Alexander's death, the Ptolemies took over. His generals took over the parts of the empire. Ptolemy I took Egypt. This is what started the Ptolemaic line of 300 years. This is what started the bloodbath during the time of the Ptolemies. They were killing each other to be on the throne. Cleopatra's father is Ptolemy the 12th. He is a Greek. That's his background. Now, her mother may have been a Kemetic African, because what the soldiers do when they come in, they rape the women. Is that right?
That's right.
So again, but we see that her background is of a Ptolemaic line. She was closer to this world than she is to ancient Kemet. She was said to be the only one to actually was able to read the Medunecer, whereas many of the other Greeks could not read the Medunecer. But the story about her is that her sister and her brother were on the throne. And her brother being Ptolemy the 13th after his father. But here, Cleopatra wanted the throne for herself. And during this time, when Julius Caesar came into Egypt, here she rolled her, the story is she rolled herself up in a rug. And when Julius Caesar was in the palace, she was able to get her loyal followers to sneak her past her sister Arsinoe, and she rolled herself out to Julius Caesar, and this is where she started to work her magic on him. And working her magic on him, he ended up in the bed with her, and then the next day, Arsinoe and her brother comes in, and Cleopatra is on the throne with Julius Caesar. But Julius Caesar wants a trophy to prove to Rome that he had conquered the Ptolemies. So what does he do? He takes Arsinoe back, Cleopatra's sister, back to Rome, and Cleopatra the 7th is with him on the throne with Cleopatra, and her sister's in a cage. And they're rolling through the streets. The people are yelling at the fact that Julius Caesar defeated Egypt. Now, because she worked her magic on Julius Caesar, she gets pregnant with Caesarion. Now, her mission is that she wants the power of ancient Egypt, as it was in ancient time, to come back. And she wants to do that through her son, Caesarion, that he would rule over Egypt and Roman Empire. That would make Egypt the world empire again. All right? But it's here that the Senate wasn't going to have that. They come back to Rome again, and with the son, Caesarion, and the Senate is upset because they know that that son could be the ruler of Rome. They kill Julius Caesar, the Senate. Cleopatra takes off, leaves Rome. And now she's upset because the mission that she thought that Egypt could be the empire was and it would rule over Rome is long gone. But there's a general. One of Julius Caesar's generals is named Mark Antony. Now, this other one named Octavian, he knows that Mark Antony is a big playboy. And he says that, okay, I will send you to Egypt. He's sending him to Egypt for a reason. knowing that Cleopatra would work her magic on him, and this would enable him to start another war with Egypt, because he knows what Mark Anthony's going to do. Sure enough, when Mark Anthony gets down to Egypt, Cleopatra works her magic on him, and she worked her magic so much on him to the fact that Mark Anthony told Rome, all the land that we've conquered in Asia, I'm giving that to Cleopatra. I mean, she whipped some stuff up on him. He said, I'm giving all this, all the blood that the Romans shed to conquer these lands, it's all going to Cleopatra, it's all going to Egypt. Oh, that made Rome mad. But that's what Octavian wanted. He wanted to go to war. So he goes to war at Actium. It was a sea battle. It was two naval wars. It was the Kemet, the Egyptian Kemet, and also Mark Anthony, who had the Roman soldiers with him, and also Octavian, who had the Roman army with him. As Cleopatra observed that they were losing the war, she takes off and goes back to Egypt. Mark Anthony sees she's taken off. So he goes back. He's following her. They're losing the war. But when Cleopatra gets to Egypt, she tells her loyal followers to tell Mark Anthony when he gets here that I committed suicide. So when Mark Anthony got there, he said, where's Cleopatra at? Why did she leave in a naval battle? They said, well, she committed suicide because she was losing the war. And he takes his Roman knife and stabs himself and kills himself. Cleopatra walks out and sees he's dead. What's her mission? She wants to work out on Octavian. Octavian's coming. And so here, Octavian comes into the palace and sees Cleopatra, but Octavian, he loves boys. So, so that ain't working. She said, what's happening? My magic ain't working. But see, he was into boys. That's what he was into. He was into men, all right? So that wasn't working at all. So she realized, hey, well, I have no other mission. So she takes and gets some of her loyal followers to go out and get a cobra. To go out to get this cobra. Why she want this cobra? Because she knows what she saw would happen to her sister, Arsinoe, as she was run through the streets of Rome before her death. So she said she'll take a royal death before she let that to be humiliated. She takes this cobra, lays it on her breast. The cobra bites her, and then she got all the loyal nobles around her and put her in a royal dress. So when Octavian runs into the room and thinks he got a trophy, because he don't want her dead, he wants a trophy for Rome to run her through the streets and everything to parade. And there she is lying out in the royal and all the royalty of a queen that one would have of ancient Egypt, where she took her life. And that trophy he did not have, and said that she was buried in Alexandria, Egypt. And because of that, that's why at that time, here we see Octavian changes his name from Octavian that represented October to August. So he becomes Augustus Caesar, because it was August 30th in 30 BCE that he defeated Cleopatra and Mark Antony. And that's what started the whole world from that time to be a Western world. Had Cleopatra won that war at that time, the center of the world would have been Africa. But because she lost that war, that's where we see that the world then comes from Rome, and the European Empire started from that particular point. A lot of debates in the States. Newsweek, especially this was during the attack on the whole African-centered movement back in 1990. So back in 1990, here Afrocentrism, was Cleopatra black, facts or fantasies, a debate rages over what to teach our kids about their roots. You see she got a red, black, and green Africa on. Many professors at university, black professors, who were in these debates. And they should never even got involved in that period, because they put her during that period, the Greeks were there. Her father was a Ptolemy. Why didn't they go back further than that? Because all they had to do was say, wait a minute, how about Ahmos Nefertari, who was 1500 years BCE before Cleopatra? Why are we starting with Cleopatra? This is all we know. With the defeat of Cleopatra, this now becomes the world power of the European power starts at this point. And it's been there for 2,000 years. From the Augustus Caesar, who came in and started to plunder, in fact, turned all the Kemetian people of the Nile Valley into slaves and made them work to make food, to grow food for Rome. Egypt became the breadbasket to feed Rome because of the alluvial topsoil that came out of the interior of Africa. This was the place, this was the breadbasket of the world. So everybody worked to feed Rome. Right. Everything was done. That was the start of this early white supremacy empire to exploit Africa. From that time out, that exploitation is still going on to this day. Many of you have asked, what has happened? What happened here? Brothers and sisters, you don't have to come here to ask what happened. Look at us. Right. How did we get to America?
Right. Talk about it.
Huh? Did you come on the Mayflower, as Malcolm used to say?
Sir.
Huh?
Nope.
Or did you come on the good ship Jesus?
Talk about it.
That was the name of the slave ships.
Right.
John Hopkins. He called the ship what?
The good ship.
Some of us is too painful to say. I understand. Our belief system can hold us in check sometime. And there was another ship called the Grace of God. We're in the bottom of those ships, but it's called the Grace of God. I know it's painful, but that's the truth. And there was another ship called the Holy Mary. The Holy Mary. What was it called? Only a few of us can say it because I know it's too painful to say. I understand. But this is the truth, and this is what started the human resources and exploitation at this time. And then England and America said, wait a minute, Africa has something much more precious than human resource. It has gold, diamonds, minerals. Okay, all those things that run your cell phone that you use. Okay, nickel, uranium, all this. So let's stop the slave trade. Don't let England tell you that all of a sudden it had some type of philanthropic feeling for Africans to stop the slave trade in America. No, leave Africans in Africa so they can exploit the land for us. Because if we take all the human resource, who's going to get, which they now find is the gold, silver, uranium, okay, bauxite, nickel, all this stuff that we have today running all this technology.
Diamond.
We asked where those diamonds come from when we wear them on our finger, and how many brothers and sisters who had to get on their knees. And I mean, these are alluvial fields, okay, in Angola in South Africa. They don't have to go and blast them out. They actually get on their knees and pick with a, put a little can around the brothers and sisters' neck while they drop the diamonds in there. But in order to keep this operation going, you've got to make the enemy the deity in the spiritual subconscious of the African's mind. Mm. So while as long as the Africans see the Europeans as the deity, they can continue to rape Africa to this very day. And the missionaries coming there, deifying themselves and their images in a white god and a white angelic realm. This is the epitome of white idolatry.